too. Sorry, Clay.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, and everyone in between, welcome to the Everything and Nothing Show. I am just one of your hostess with the Moses, the jet plane flying, limousine driving, wheeling, dealing, son of a gun, Clayton Kisco. And I'm accompanied, of course, by the rest of the Maelstrom Gamers. On this podcast today, we have with us the bad boy, Steve Landis. What's up, Steve? How's it going? Bad boys.
Oh, I don't know.
Bad boy, you're breaking up. But what he was basically
doing. Oh, see you later.
Next up, we have, and last but certainly not least, the man, the legend, a.k.a. Backdoor, the heartthrob, Rocco Avellino.
The most amazing, the most intelligent, the most talented, the strongest, the best looking, the Bono impersonator, whatever. Like, I don't know, man. You can't just give yourself some awesome shit and then line me up with this, the last guy. The last guy. Thanks, bro.
Yeah, touche. So, we're all here. What you guys been playing lately?
No Man's Sky and Smite still. So
No Man's Sky and Smite. Nice.
No Man's Sky, man.
How is No Man's Sky?
I like it a lot. Okay. It's a different kind of play than what I think a lot of people were expecting.
Yeah.
I think they were expecting it to be like MMO and stuff like that. No MMO at all.
Yeah.
Other than that, I think it's exactly what I expected. It's going to be like an exploration game. You're going to do a lot of mining and a lot of learning how to like construct. It's going to be crafting. I think it's a lot of fun. Like so far, like the traveling experience has been pretty cool. Like traveling from one galaxy to another, or solar system to another. I haven't traveled from a galaxy to another galaxy, but I've traveled. In the beginning, it's like you travel from a planet to a planet kind of thing. Get your ship all built up, and then you can start traveling. Like once you get your warp drive, you can travel out of the solar system. It's pretty cool, though.
Yeah. All right. We'll have to do like a topic on that, because that's what, from what I understand, the people who had played No Man's Sky, they're like, we don't think people's expectations are going to be met.
Even the creator, I think, came out like the day of or the day before and was saying the same thing, like, guys, I just want to make this very clear.
Yeah.
Like, it's not be like this.
Like, it's gotta be frustrating, right? Where you're like, it's a good idea, and they're like, that's a great idea, but you're gonna do this, and you're like, no, it was a great idea, but I can't do all that other stuff. Well, it's like, yeah, and you'll do this, and it's like, nah, I don't care.
The thing that sucks about that is like expectations, like when we create those as individuals, and especially when they're false expectations, like when we get it, it's always a disappointment. And it's like No Man's Sky can be so amazing to a lot of people if they didn't create those expectations.
Yeah.
Because then they go to play it and they can be like, oh, this game sucks. Because they were expecting something like battling other people in starships and then there being some like warfare on the ground on planets and seeing other people. Like,
yeah.
Now.
I think Steve is wrestling with his laptop.
It sounds like
I'm trying to get
the laptop has become sentient. Yeah, and then has just dropped a series of elbows onto Steve's back, and now Steve is retaliating.
Right, give me a call.
Like the laptop a headlock. Right.
Headlock.
And then they're just wrestling. They're wrestling out there. I'm going to have to give him a call back.
Hey, by the way, talking about going to sleep, I saw a kangaroo choke out another kangaroo in a sleeper hold and put that fucker down.
Wow.
It was so cool.
It was like, dude, kangaroos are crazy.
And he's just staring at the camera like this.
Okay, all right. There's so much.
Looking at the camera, not even looking at anything else.
There's so much going on right now. There's so much.
Am I back?
Yeah, you're back. This is crazy. Oh.
No. Stop. Your introduction was over.
Steve, we're gonna get copywritten claimed because of that.
No, we're not.
Okay, wow. Like, you're just gonna have to watch this intro because so much stuff was good. Like, Rocco was talking about a headlock, and the second he said he got into a headlock, like, you left the call, and the camera focused on his eyes and his lips at the same time in two different windows. Like, it was crazy. And then you came back, and you're doing the shuffle, and Bad Boys is going, like, my head's spinning from, like, just everything that just happened. And now I gotta fix Rocco's head because it's, like, all, like, out of whack. So, okay, for those of you guys who don't know, the format of the show is pretty simple. Us Maelstrom Gamers, we hop on a Skype each and every week, and we each bring five topics for our discussion, but more importantly for your entertainment, and bring those topics, become videos on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/Maelstrom Gamers channel, and they're doled out Monday through Friday, topic by topic, video by video, and on Saturday, all the videos are rolled up into one big video episode. that you can get all for free. If you would like to give us as little as a dollar, it'd be super helpful and appreciated because it'd go back into our show. You go to patreon.com/maelstromgamers and just maybe one time a dollar drop. It's like a tip jar. Think of it like a tip jar. You kind of come on, you see our stuff, our posts, and you're like, oh, these guys are pretty funny. They're mildly entertaining. They try really hard. So I'm going to give them a little A for effort here and just drop a dollar in the bucket for them. I won't have to do it every month, but maybe just a dollar. And you could do that on patreon.com. It'd be super helpful. And look, I get it. You might be in college and, you know, you are poor as hell. And the economy is shit right now. And you're like, look, I really want to support this top 10 iTunes podcast, right? But the problem is I just don't have money.
Now.
Yeah, we're top 10. We moved up. And the problem is I just don't have the money. So there's free ways to do that, too. You can go on to our YouTube page. You can go on to our Facebook page, Twitter, Instagram. You can comment, like, subscribe, and share all of our stuff. And that helps. We want to hear from you. We also want to kind of grow the audience base. And it's so far so good. So keep it up. And thank you for everyone who's done that so far. We made a shout out to David Fry last time for being our biggest contributor so far. We also made a shout out to Renee Landis. She's MVP of sharing and liking and supporting our channel. So thanks again, Renee. So yeah, that's our supporters. That's our
hey guys too as well.
It's actually pronounced Renee.
Oh, Renee.
I just felt like saying that.
Well, now I'm not gonna stop. And look, if you like what you're hearing and you like what you're seeing, you can hop on to YouTube as well and watch us stream our mediocre gaming skills on Smite, on No Man's Sky, on some Uncharted, on some League, Late Night Whispers, all this good fun stuff. So check us out. And then come play with us. Our handles are in the description. You can friend us and you can play with us. We want to play with you.
Yes, sir.
I'm not pointing at my penis. I'm just saying. All right. There.
No, we won't want that. Little kids out there watching.
I'm sorry.
So let's...
Little kids know what that is.
Wow. Well, let's get started.
Well...
I mean, not like in a perverted way. I mean, it should. Right. It's your body.
Sure.
Come on.
It's just... You just made it weird.
Adults.
Yeah, I'm just freaked out a little bit.
Adults.
Rocco, continue to freak us out. Give us your topic.
Of course.
Or just stutter.
Sorry. Okay, so let's start this off.
All right.
Let's talk about what I like to call little steps, okay?
Okay.
It's where you go like this, and you take small steps really fast.
Okay, I can do that.
Oh, okay, yeah. No. Yeah, so the little steps is this, okay? It's like the little steps are when you're trying to reach a goal, like a big goal, right? Like you see all the Olympics going on right now, and their big goal is trying to get to a gold medal.
Yes.
What you don't see, though, is the little steps that were happening all throughout the time, the 4 years before they got up to the Olympics, right? Mm-hmm. All you see is that event that happens, that occurs, and they get that gold medal, that big event. But all those little steps were necessary to get to even having that goal achieved, that big goal. And those little steps are very important. And I think what happens is that a lot of us, like, don't think of those little steps as how important they are, and we get caught up in those everyday kind of situations. So here's an example real fast. In a game that I play called Smite, you have to master 18 champions before you can play in ranked. So when I would start to master these champions, you have to play around sometimes between 5 games if you're playing really well up to like 10 games if you're not playing that well to master that champion. So when I would start to play some of these champions, I would play the first game and I'd go in and I'd be like, this beep champion is like the worst champion ever, like the most terrible champion. Whoever developed this guy was... just had some screw loose because his abilities don't match.
You monkey.
It's awful. It's
Make
awful.
Us low key.
But the thing was this. So, like, I kept my focus on the end game goal, which was I have to master this champion. Regardless if I like him, regardless if his abilities don't work, whatever it is, I have to master this champion. So I kept my focus on the goal, and I put the day in, and I put the next day in, and the next day in. And by the time that I mastered that champion, I was like, this champion's the best champion. Whoever developed this guy, he knew how his abilities work in sync, man. This guy is amazing. He can destroy everybody.
Yeah.
But if I had got myself caught up on those day-to-day steps, those little steps, I would have been like, screw this guy. I'm going to play a new champion and start all over with somebody else. And instead of keeping the focus on, I'm going to master him no matter what, I got through my little steps, and all of a sudden I achieved that goal. And what we don't see is that, like, we don't keep that focus on the end game goal. We just look at that little step and we go, bleh, I'm done. And that's something important. That even applies to, like, my sales job, right? I could go a day and a day and a day and a day and zero, 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 zero. If I keep my focus on the I want 20 sales a month goal, then I know I'm going out there and I'm doing all this different stuff to try to achieve that goal, a 20 sales goal. If I keep my focus on the zero goal, that I mean the zero sales that happened that day, I'll get myself into a rut. I'll get myself locked into this, like, this you know, snowball effect of, like, negativity. And then possibly quit. Possibly not achieve that goal that I was keeping my focus on. And not just see that as a little step throughout that day to achieve the big goal later on. Mm. You know what I mean? So my topic is just about that and about putting an awareness on those little steps. And perhaps you guys can see some examples that you've done in your life recently. Like, for example, Steve, I know you're doing, you know, League of Legends a lot as of right now. So you're taking obviously little steps. Like, I don't know if you have a goal.
Yeah,
End game goal. Like, do you have an end game goal? Have you actually specifically said, I'm going to make
He's told me his end
game goal. You know
what I mean?
I've had
to punch Clay in the face when playing with him, and he fucks up and ruins the entire game and brings Steve down to bronze. He's got to take a breather and remember that the path to gold is there and to not get frustrated and leave.
No, on my screen, I actually have gold. I don't have a certain level of gold. It just says gold.
You should be specific with it, because that could mean five, it could mean one. You know what I mean? And so, like, if you have a bad game or whatever it is, you just keep your focus on that goal instead of anything else that had occurred. You know what I mean? Like, you're like, that was just practice, whether it was good or bad practice, getting myself to that goal. Like, I'm getting to that goal every day. I'm working towards it.
And that's what's changing my mindset in the game a lot too. Is I've been picking
like less stressed or more learning.
Well, more learning, because if you're stressed, you're not going to be able to focus on learning, pretty much. You're just going to be focused on, like, bad games. And then I was just starting to focus on, like, okay, what did I do differently? What could I have done?
So here's my train of thought about why that occurs, okay? Because this is just a belief, okay? But I think this is how I see the reality in my eyes. Whenever you have a belief or whatever it is, like, you have your goal, it's I'm going to be gold, right? You keep thinking that, you keep seeing that. What happens is that creates thoughts and actions to create that goal to come true. So your now actions and thoughts have changed. You now view the game differently. You're now viewing it as in, what am I doing wrong to improve myself? Which is the exact thoughts you need to eventually create the outcome of gold, right? Mm-hmm. So it's like, what I see is that, like, based off of whatever you got as your belief, your belief is I'm going to be gold, then you start to create these thoughts and other actions that are going to start to apply that. Now, if it's negative, it's like, oh, I'm fucking shitty, then you're going to create negative thoughts, negative actions that are going to occur and create that to be the outcome of your outcome is I'm a shitty player, if that's what it is you believe. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's how I guess I see it. So, like, it's changing, I guess, how you view the game. Is the way that I see that occurring. So, like, now you've been talking about asking Richard, you know, Richard, another player that's kind of in platinum right now, and asking him to, like, kind of analyze what you're doing. Am I correct?
Yeah, pretty much. Like, I just tell him if there's anything I can do differently and everything, he'll let me know.
What have you seen since you've been changing up the learning and the thought process? Have you been increasing, like, in your I guess, a bracket?
Yeah. I got the 77 LP. I was almost actually in my provisionals, and then we had a couple bad games and everything like that.
I was not a part of the bad games.
he wasn't a part of those ones.
We won the one I played with.
What about you, Clay? Like, have you noticed anything like that you got going on in life?
Yes. I'm saving for a new computer. It has been almost a 9 month, 12 month, like. You know, every month you put some money away, and it's really easy to be like, oh, Overwatch came out, I could probably just take 60 here, and then, like, you know, oh man, everybody's going to this, I could probably just take 50 out, and then, oh, this new game came out, I could probably just take another 60 or 100 because Legion, I want to play World of Warcraft, and it's like, well, I could, but then it's death by 1,000 cuts, right, that like are spread out so enough where, you know, you don't feel that impact of what it is, but in reality, like, my willpower is still there, and I'm like, okay, every month it's just a baby step closer, and so now I'm about a month off getting that new computer, so that's pretty exciting. Did the same thing with my tattoo. So that's really been my, like, my small steps to a bigger goal kind of thing as of late. There's also some stuff from work, you know, starting a new job, just trying to, like, set goals and, like, and slowly, like, understand one concept at a time to build to that goal.
So something I had recently happen in mine is that I just recently got a truck, which was something that was on my goal board for a while. You know, I've been talking about the truck, I think, for about 9 months. I've had it on the goal board since we created it about, like, 2.5 months ago. And we just ripped it off the goal board because it was finally all those small steps worked its way up to the big step, which was, bam, there it is. Now you
saving money and then
doing the things that were necessary to get to the point where you can have that as a reality. You know, but actions started occurring and thoughts started occurring to make it so that that could become, because it was such a focus in my mind always, it started to allow those to become such as a, since it's a focus, it's something I'm putting my thoughts to. It's like, starts to create more actions towards that.
Did you have
I remember I'm trying to get a truck.
Did you have any setbacks in that? Because, like, those things can just...
Of course. Well, so I view setbacks as areas for growth. Okay? Yeah. Like, I look at setbacks as, like, you can only go further. It's like the archer kind of, like, saying. It's like, you have to take the arrow and you got to pull it back first to let it go launch out. You know what I mean? That. Like, I see life that way. Like, that old... I think I told you guys the Chinese saying of, like, the farmer goes and his horses leave, come back. Did I ever tell you guys that one?
No.
Okay.
I always talk about.
Yeah. Anyways, it's just about don't like label things as good or bad, because you really don't know at the end of the day, like, why they're occurring. Like, horses go away, bad idea, come back. There's tons of horses, good idea. Son rides the horse, he falls off, breaks his arm, bad. You know, but the Chinese army comes the next day to recruit the son. The son can't get recruited because he has a broken arm. Good. You know, it's like, don't judge whether they're good or bad. Like, you never know, really, why an event is occurring and happening. Yeah. So, like, yeah, there was what you would call or label as setbacks and things like that. But, all successful people I've ever seen in my life, no matter where they came from, art, they came from, you know, actors, actresses, they were musicians, they were businessmen. You know, they were whatever that, you know, it doesn't matter where they came from. The one common denominator that I saw in successful people is belief in themselves, no matter what, the most unbelievable self-confidence there, because they've had people tell them that they're not going to make it, that they will never get the parts that they want, that they will be unsuccessful or whatever it is. And they never believe that. They would believe in themselves and in their goal of achieving that. And so no hurdle was ever seen as something that was going to stop them. Mm-hmm. And they achieved it because no matter what, they weren't going to stop till that goal was achieved.
So you're talking about small steps in order to, like, kind of build
work your way to the big step.
Right. Yeah. And then also hold that level of confidence and believing in yourself to, like when things are tough, right? Like, that you can kind of keep going and don't believe that all.
And another way to get through those small steps is to maybe change your focus to the big step. You know what I mean? Instead of looking at that small step that day, know that it's just a small step to achieve the big step. You know what I mean? Because it could be tough to be, oh, wow, I got a zero today in my small step in sales.
I also think it's interesting that, like, too many small steps could be a bad thing. Like, because I feel like if you have this goal of, like, I'm going to be an Olympic swimmer, and it's like, Clay, you've never swam professionally in your life. Like, this is fine, it's fine. But, like, you know, like, a bigger goal, intermediate goal, would be, like, just, you know, compete at a local swimming tournament, right? And, like, work your way.
That would be, exactly. So I say... If you have this is how I think of it. If you have the big goal of being the Olympic swimmer, it's up there. Okay. That's fine to be there. Now, that process of being that intermediate swimmer is going to occur somewhere along that line. It'll be one of the small steps too. So I look at it as you know, some way or another to start yourself off to be an Olympic swimmer right now, don't you?
Yeah.
You know, one step, you know, at least the step one, don't you? To start becoming an Olympic swimmer. Nice. Step two, you don't need to know the details about that. You ask any millionaire, did you know every detail that was going to occur to make you a millionaire? And I bet you everyone will say no. They didn't know what step two was going to be. They just did what they knew step one was. Step two occurred, and then now they started doing step two whenever that happened. Then step three came, and then they started doing step three. Everything working their way up to the Olympic gold swimmer will start to come to you, because what happens is you start to open those doors of opportunity by being involved in those steps and making that action occur. So I see it as, like, you might not know 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 or whatever it takes to get you all the way to there. You can't plan all of that. You won't know that. What you can plan, though, is at least step one. You know that you got to get in the fucking pool and start working your body out and start swimming. And from there, I'm sure you can find out step two, which is like getting in a community of people that are swimmers. And then step three probably occurs that you're in a competitive swim for at least your first one. Step four goes you're going to the tournaments of the regional area. You have no clue. It just probably occurs.
Yeah.
Step it's like five, think of anything that happens
in
drugs.
Think in retro in your memory.
Step six,
how
profit.
Anything got from how you got from one goal to the end goal. You probably didn't know every step that was going to happen in between. Think about it even on your own level.
Yeah, that's pretty
you
true.
You know what I mean?
There's a lot of outside circumstances too. I feel
and
like working
are,
out.
I think those are factors that help you in life.
Sure, yeah.
I think we'll look at them
point.
As synchronicities, I call them, you know, where one thing lines up with another to make you help achieve that goal later on that you had no clue that person or event or whatever it was going to come into your life.
Yeah.
To make, you know, you'd get from point A to point B.
That's definitely something I've learned over time and as I've gotten older and like had those unpredictable things happen and fear the worst, think that it's going to be bad and see that, wow, I wouldn't have been exactly achieving this if it wasn't for that bad thing that had happened or perceived to be bad thing, right? So that's really
age interesting. Age did bring it around too for me. Like it's definitely getting older and the more maturity. And the children is a big deal too because it adds another responsibility to your life and then adds another level of thought, like deeper thought.
Yeah,
in the sense of like,
you're right.
And now I got to think a little bit deeper than all the shit that I've been doing before because I'm a lot more responsible and I have like the future of like other individuals in my hands. Like,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah. I don't know what to do with my hands.
Babies in your hands. And you're like, I got to do something with these guys. And even with that process, right? Look at that process. Did you know every detail that you were going to get from where you were at the beginning, Clay, to where you are now?
What, with
right?
kids?
Like with a kid, right?
I knew
like,
everything. I read all the books.
No, of course not. They've all been right.
All the different steps I went through, but look at where you were at now, right? 12 hours of sleep, all these different things. Like,
oh,
it's where you guys wanted to get to, but look at all the little steps that had to occur to get there. You know what I mean? Like, you would have never been able to paint all the things that would have had to happen to get there.
No, it's wild. And it's cool because with each new day, right, that time in our lives, those 3 months, 4 months, where it was just like no sleep whatsoever and like just everything was about having a kid, like that, at the time, it felt like this was never going to end and we were never going to get back to normal. And now it feels like a very small,
this too shall pass.
Just
like,
and,
but
pass.
Like you have to hold that true whenever
that,
you're going through those experiences.
No. My saying is none shall pass, quoted by the late great Black Knight.
Yes.
None shall pass.
Sir, I've passed
it's
you in combat. No, you have not.
So what you're saying, Clay, is you guys are gonna have another kid pretty soon?
What's up?
So what you're saying is you're having another kid pretty soon, then?
Yeah, we're gonna have three.
Oh yeah, bam!
We're going triplets.
All right away.
Yeah, no. No, I mean, we like are like, oh my god, it'd be so great to clone this little one. Or like, oh, it'd be great to have a little daughter. And it's like, and then we're like, we get a little serious tone. We're like, yeah, another kid. And we're like, yeah, that's not gonna happen right now.
We
can't
the way
do
we
it.
Felt.
I mean,
right
give us
happening.
A year. I mean, well, her body's gotta like. they say you
it's
gotta
funny
have 18
too.
Months, right? Like between birth. So.
No, she. I honestly, right like, it took me a second for us to wanting to have another one too, and then when we knew we wanted to, we just wanted to make sure we had an idea of like 3 years, you know, because it was like my brother and I were 3 years, so we had that kind of going. But
yeah, 3 years is nice.
Hey, let's move on to this next topic, right?
Okay.
But I want to leave these guys with one last thing, real quick. Okay. This is a saying that I try to hold true, like to a lot of things. It goes, if you failed to plan. Then you've planned to fail. Okay? That's something like, that's, I'm just saying, it's a saying though, like that I really try to think of. It's very important because like really, if you think about it, if you failed to plan, then you've planned to fail. So you don't have no direction, no way of which way you're trying to go. And even, you don't even know what step one would be because you're throwing out nothing.
It makes a big difference.
Yeah.
Honestly. Okay, cool. Yeah, let's move on. We're going to go to my topic. I heard this on the NPR article, and I have my, like, in my history about standing in line for stuff. We do it as a society, like, it's like the one thing that I feel like has been created since the dawn of goddamn time. It's like all these people want one thing, or all these people want all of these things, but there's one person handing it out. Okay. Fucking stand in a line. Like, if you ever saw that horrible movie Michael with John Travolta about Michael the Archangel, where he's like, yeah, dude, I created a line. Everybody's just standing around. I was like, why don't you guys just go in a line, right?
Get in
like
a line.
It was like single file, one by one. We wait at like sheep or cattle for our turn to get the thing that we want because like on the other side, there's just not enough people to distribute it, right? So it got me thinking about what is, you know, the longest line you stood in for something that you wanted. I'm curious, like, and you know, and there's a lot of like other nuggets in there, like, how long is too long of a line? Like, is there something that you would stand in a line for multiple days for? Like, there are people who camp out weeks in advance for certain things, like movie tickets, for instance, right? Because they're just diehard fans. So I'm curious what you guys think about that, and if there's something that you would do for it.
Yeah, Twilight.
Definitely Twilight. I mean, I stood in line.
Did you really?
50 hours for Twilight.
Camped out for the. Oh.
People did though. People did. I couldn't believe it. I was like, Twilight, really?
You're such a troll, dude. Get your troll face.
People, guys. There is definitely love for that. Vampire sparkle.
Okay, so camp out, like, or like long lines. I guess it all depends on like what it is that you're getting at the end of there. Because if it was like an ice cream cone, I wouldn't wait fucking 5 hours for an ice cream cone. You know what I mean? Like it all has. It's like
would you wait 15 minutes
for an ice cream cone? Yeah. Nope. I wouldn't wait 25 minutes for an ice cream.
What about 10 minutes?
I would wait 10 minutes for an ice
cream
cone.
But 15 minutes is too much. That's the cutoff point.
15 minutes feels like if I see a line that looks like it's 15 minutes long, I'll leave. I won't even stay at Haagen-Dazs.
So,
I'll move on out.
Okay, so what about a restaurant for food, right? Oftentimes.
Ah, that's a good one, too.
15 to 20 minutes.
Okay. An hour long wait for a really good restaurant that I've been like set on for me. If it's a restaurant, we're just kind of like, hey, you want to go to Applebee's? Oh, yeah, let's just go to Applebee's. And we walk in, and they're like, an hour? Be like, nah, we're going somewhere else.
Fucking out of here.
So are those ones Applebee's. We would probably do like a 30 to 40 minute wait at the longest, you know?
That's really funny because most, like, at Max, I know hostess for a fact. We'll be like, oh, it's like a 40 minute wait. Like, if it's an hour and a half projected, they'll tell you 40 minutes. They will lie to your face.
And they're snakes. Those are the ones that I get, like, angry with. Like, I'll start staring them down.
The 12-year-old, like, middle school girls who are, like, their
first job. I don't care. She lied to me. I don't care who you are and how old you are. If I'm sitting there, or he, whoever it is, if I'm sitting there and my buzzer hasn't gone off and you told me it was going to be 40 minutes and it's now an hour, you better believe
you going to Olive Garden?
You either stare down, like, I'm going to rip your heart out, or I've gone off on you. And I plan on leaving the facility knowing that I've gone too far. Like,
you're not waiting for
throw that
pager
at their face.
For the unending salad.
Fuck your buzzer. Like,
those chilled
I'm
plates.
Taking this buzzer.
This is mine. I've waited long enough.
Perfectly buttered breadsticks. I'm not waiting 40 minutes for those things.
Get me my honey butter.
No, but there has been some places that have been like that. That actually is really cool where they bring out people appetite.
Yeah.
Appetizers.
They bring them appetizers.
Appetizers.
I like appetizers.
Yeah, appetizers are pretty good.
They're that new tasty thing coming around the corner, right?
What is it? The walrus has oddly shaped.
I really don't mind if I have a beer. If I have a beer in my hand, I probably could wait for a while.
That really
as
is.
As long as
like
I keep
solid.
The beers coming.
If you got time
you know?
To kill, like if you don't have anywhere to be, and it's like, oh, it's going to be like a half hour wait, you know, hour wait, but you could stand by you can go to the bar and have a drink. I'm like, yeah, let's do it.
Okay, so longest that we've actually waited? I waited, I think it was 22 hours for the Nintendo Wii when it first came out.
Yeah.
I waited at Sears in college in Savannah.
But I don't know if it was at Sears. I think it might have been at like Walmart or Best Buy.
I thought you were at Walmart.
Okay. Nope, I was at Sears.
Okay. Sears was selling Wiis. That's funny.
And guess what, bro? We got in the line figuring out that they were going to sell Wiis, and we got there. It was me and my friend, Seth, at the time, and we sat there for 22 fucking hours. We got there. We were the first two, and then there was lines that were there, like getting longer and longer and longer and longer, and when they opened up the doors, they only had two fucking Wiis. We grabbed them, and we left. Everybody was staring us down. We're like, dude, we got to get out of here. I feel like we're going to get jumped.
Yeah, well,
I was
a
like,
lot of times
I was like,
security.
I might sell my Wii to somebody.
Could you imagine if you did?
$1,000 Wii, like
some people were doing that with like the N64, weren't they? Like
yeah,
when it first
I didn't
came
do
out.
It though
like,
because I really wanted the Wii. Like I really wanted
in
to experience
hindsight.
The whole. Yeah, I should have so done it.
Yeah.
Like
oh
so
yeah,
done it. I just didn't think
you
of
want
to
that,
do it.
That waggle,
people
dude.
Were trying to like buy it though. They were trying. How much do you want for it? I was like, no, man, no. And I was like, oh, I gotta get the fuck out of here. Like.
I did the same
thing. Before they tell me a number, I can't.
Put it on my shirt and let's run.
I went somewhere for the Wii, but I remember standing for a really long time as well. Not 22 hours, though. Like, I stood in line from like 5 to like midnight or something stupid like that.
I worked at Best Buy in college, and I knew that the Best Buy ones were like shot. But I heard that Sears was going to offer them, which is why we got it in a line way early. So we just spent the night out there. We got Red Bulls. We stayed up all night just talking and had music playing. And we didn't have a tent or anything else. We just sat there.
Wow.
The things you could do in college, right? Like,
yeah, we just sat there and talked.
Did anyone try to cut or anything like that?
No, bro. We were playing around. We were doing daily 5 o'clock in the morning workouts and then 8 o'clock lacrosse workouts. I was in the best shape of my life. You better have been ready. I was going to get my weed. I didn't care. And that line thing is serious, too, Clay. Anybody tries to cut that, that's a serious thing. At least in my world, it's like somebody goes and cuts. I'm not the guy that's like, I can't believe you cut. I'd be like, sir, get the fuck out of my way. Like, I've been here. I'm here. Like,
when someone says, sir,
you see
before
me.
Before that, they know they mean business.
It's on. I'm serious. Like, this is your warning. That, sir, was your first threat.
Sir.
The words that came after the sir are your second threat. The touch on your shoulder is your third, and now I'm done. Like, you say one thing.
For 20 hours. Get your ass out of here. Your polka dot.
I'm watching Twilight first.
Your dumb mermaid lunchbox. Get out of here.
I can't stand the cutters in line, man. I've never been able to, even in school, I couldn't do it.
You never did backsies? You never did backsies cuts?
Like, nope, I never cut people, but I'm going to cut you. I'm all about fair, bro. Like, it's always been about fairness in my life, like, for whatever reason. I was like, I won't do it to somebody, but they sure won't do it to me neither, though. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not going to cut you, but you ain't going to cut me neither.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But that was my longest wait, 22 hours for the weed, and it was...
Have you ever, like, called out?
I would do it again. Like,
no, yeah. So I did the 360 in freshman or sophomore year of college as well. And that was a long – I remember waiting a long time for that too. And then I know my dad would wait in line. Like, I remember calling him after doing this, and I was exhausted. I was like, Dad, like, thank you so much for, like, all the years that you waited in line for toys I wanted for Christmas. And, like, after work, coming home after work, driving to New York and, like, waiting in line. And, like, trying to get stuff.
New York,
like,
must have been insane with that. All I can think about when I think about that kind of stuff is, like, the Jingle All the Way, I think it's called.
Yeah,
like, Schwarzenegger.
Yeah. There's no Amazon.
Gotta get the toy. Yeah. Gotta get the toy.
you literally have... So what he would do is he wakes up at 4, drives to work at 5, is at work until, like, 5, drives into New York, and then scours the various different shops. F.A.O. Schwartz, Toys R Us.
Your dad loves you.
All this, yeah. And
I would have been like... Walmart, they're getting this. Like,
yeah, they're getting this. This ain't Turbo Man. This is Squid,
this
dude.
This
is
like Turbo Man.
Yeah.
This
is very
fast. I want
fast
Turbo
guy.
Man, Dad. Yeah. Oh, you know, this is he's the guy. Yeah. He's a guy.
This is a
guy.
Look, he's got 3 speeds.
Hola, ¿cómo estás? Me refiero.
Fucking Spanish.
Take away.
Is that Italian?
It's kind of mixed. Going back to our accents, we're really terrible with this.
Barabina
meant a pepperoni pizza. That's Spanish.
Oh, it's not Pinky Brain. Okay. All right, my wife was saying that accent was Pinky in the Brain, but it's not Pinky in the Brain. Pinky's accent is more like like Alfred's in the Nolan trilogies, right? Whereas I think so, Brian. I'm not sure, but
you
could, like, it's very, like, quick and short. Yeah,
I could do that.
But the accent I was doing was more like John. I believe John Lennon, where he's like, "Oh yeah, totally. I really like what you're doing, man. But I'm not sure if you get the key right."
This is just trying to show you guys his
he's good. That guy's good.
I'm gonna be a voice actor, and I'm gonna set the small steps of goals, and it's gonna happen. Because
remember, you're not gonna get paid the right
what
the. You're not going to get paid right, though, for that, remember?
That's it's fine. I don't care. It's fun to do. I don't even care.
I don't care.
Is
that a white chick?
What's the longest wait you've done? Seriously.
Honestly, I don't know. Like, I was trying to think that entire time. I was thinking mainly, like, I don't know, like, waiting in line at Disney World or something like that.
Yeah.
For, like, a ride. But, like, those are just lines. You know, those are lines. I mean,
no, that,
I remember
that counts.
Yeah, but
like,
even
you're
that, yeah,
for,
that
like,
counts. Too,
like,
30
seconds.
Well, it was because of the girls. It was mainly the girls. Like, so, like, that the new ride that came out at Disney World, it was
Harry Potter one?
The Elf. No, the Elf ones or whatever. Like, not the Elf ones. Seven Dwarves. Like, the roller coaster Seven Dwarves.
What?
It's 2.5 hour wait.
For Snow White, Seven Dwarf. Roller coaster
ride?
Why is
a roller coaster?
Roller coaster. And it was over. It was over in like 30 seconds.
Yeah. Was it
two and a half hours?
2.5 hours, man. So like we were waiting there for a long time. And that was right when we got in the park. And like
I would have told my kids to like time. 10 minutes in. Oh god.
We gotta go. Killed our phone batteries pretty much. Yeah. So like that was pretty much it.
Oh
yeah.
My god.
Yeah.
Did you leave after that?
No.
You know, like we ended up going to the line for 2 hours.
The cool
you
thing
get in
was,
there in the morning, you're like, guys, what a great start. You get in the first line. It's like the day's over by the time you get out. You're
this
like,
is
what?
So
what?
Why you bring grandma so and grandpa hot. Because they don't want to do anything. So you roll them up in their wheelchair. And you're like, all right, grandma, we'll be back. You text us.
No, 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 no. Like, this is what you do. You bring them with you. You get to bypass those lines with people in wheelchairs. Yeah. They're like, oh, wheelchair? Oh, you come up ahead of the line. And you go all the way to the front. This happened when my stepdad broke his leg and he was in a wheelchair.
And that's why it's 2.5 hours long.
That's why you
because
break your leg before you go to Disney. You gotta, if you want to go to Disney, you got to be in a wheelchair.
How does a guy with a broken leg get to go on a roller coaster ride?
Well, he didn't go on the roller coaster ones, but like every other ones that we went onto that he could get onto.
Where there's no lines?
Not the teacups, like the haunted house and things like this, where there's long lines, you know what I mean? Like we got into those like this, where there was an hour long, and we only had to wait 5 minutes, and we were
that's
on the ride.
Sweet, man.
I was like, hell yeah, we got to break your leg every time.
Yeah, yeah.
Like we'll come
the other one. Better. Wait,
maybe
wait.
I know. Faster.
This is the loophole of bypassing the Disney lines.
Well, it's pretty stupid. No, like, I miss going
break
to
leg.
Theme parks, but waiting 2 hours for one ride. I mean, what you see? Three,
cool,
on three roller coaster rides is fucking.
But that was the most popular ride, and the girls did want to go on it. So, like, you know, that's the whole experience. They wanted to do it, and the thing was right after that, we had the three express passes that you get like a day to go on things. So, like, right after that, we went to like the haunted house, and we
can't
got
you
on there like. In a second, and then
can't
we went
you
to
buy
another
those?
One, another one.
Those express passes didn't work.
Not
for
anymore.
That
not anymore.
How come
because,
they didn't work for the roller coaster?
Yeah.
Well, the thing was, is I didn't find out about the app until like
fucking
I would say a day
Steve.
Before.
Fucking
and the thing
Steve.
Is I would have found out about a week before. We probably only had to wait like a half an hour.
Yeah, Steve. Look at you ruined it, man.
Hey,
had you just done...
I got the rest of them. I got the
oh,
rest.
Man,
of them.
Oh, they
two
were sold
and
out.
Half hours.
Yeah, like. They don't do an express pass that you can buy anymore. They have an app for it, and you basically it's free.
You get one express pass for that ride or something.
You get three. You get three, but it has to be three different rides.
Gotcha. Wow. Oh, that's it. You get three total for the whole.
Yeah, for the whole park. So you gotta pick your things.
That's interesting.
Like, right.
Gotcha.
It's like yeah. Okay. It's like 11.
I wish they went back to you could buy it, because then that would be if I was gonna go to Disney.
Well, they let you
just,
buy it at Universal now, like for like the haunted house, like the Halloween Horror Nights, mm-hmm. and
oh,
I recommend you guys do that. You guys do that every time. Like, I mean, it's not like 90 extra bucks or like I think 80 extra bucks, but the thing is, you get to go on everything. Like, otherwise, you're gonna be waiting in line. Well, that's another line that I've waited like 2 hours.
You
two
wait in
hours
line to get
to,
a
like,
thing so you can wait in line.
Like
isn't that funny?
Well, the thing. Yeah, but the
oh,
thing
gosh,
is,
gosh, I
like,
hate that
was,
too. Wait in line to get a ticket, to wait in line to get in, and like
to wait in line to get like you know a $10 soda, that's 8 ounces.
There was so many haunted houses, and we only went to like three. Like we honestly only went to three, and there must have been like at least like I don't know 10 or something like that.
Do you know what
you
he's talking about there, Clay? This is where they set up the entire mm-hmm. theme park as a haunted house.
Yeah,
pretty
the
much
problem,
place, like,
the problem with Seattle is that we have no theme parks whatsoever. Like the closest one is like in California. I mean, that's not true, but like
check,
the closest
like,
legit one is in California. Yeah, there's no red flags in here. Or like
really?
It is, but it's in like Spokane. And I'm
no
not going to drive 4 hours just to go to
oh, I'm at
you know
Six
I mean?
Flags. Sorry, I don't mean red flags.
Flags. I was like, red flags.
Red flags.
What the hell is this?
Everything
like,
is suspicious.
Army, like, base. Like,
that doesn't suspicious. Look good.
Red flags. Where are the red flags?
That, that cart just fell off the roller coaster. That's a red flag.
That's
I don't
a red
think
flag.
Go
a red flag theme park.
That person just threw up from taking a bite of that hot dog.
That's
I
a red flag.
The red flag.
The most like it. We should call the
park you've
we
ever
should,
been
and
to.
That should be like the commercials for the theme park.
Yeah.
That's a red flag. Are you trying to tell me this shit happens at your theme park? Like, no, but that's a red flag.
Yeah, that's a terrible moniker.
Even the commercials a red flag.
Brought to you by yeah.
Brought to you by
going.
That's a red flag.
Yeah. All right, cool. Well, let's move on to our next topic. Rocco, it's your topic, buddy.
Okay, are you a DIY kind of guy?
Explain DIY for those who at home
are
don't
you
know.
A do-it-yourself?
Explain do-it-yourself for those who don't
know. And I'm not talking about
do
going in the shower and doing it yourself.
Not, well,
I'm talking about, are you the kind of guy that will say, all right, I need to get this kind of stuff done, either around the house, with the computers, with cars, with whatever it be, and you decide that, you know what, I'm going to try to attempt to do it myself and even actually do it myself instead of calling somebody else? Are you the guy that goes, fuck that shit, I'm just going to do that, and I'm going to call that guy up, and I'm just going to have them come over, and I'm just going to pay them, and then I don't even have to do anything? What kind of guy are you?
I'm definitely a do-it-yourselfer.
Yeah, like, do you do?
I don't know, like, anything like...
What do you do?
Well, as far as, like, the car and everything like that, like, like, paying $1,500, like, the part's only, like, $200, and you're paying $1,500, like... Mm-hmm. Holy shit, like, that's huge inflation or something like that. But, like,
yeah, exactly, the labor costs.
Yeah, but, like, how much... That's crazy for the labor costs, like... I understand people need to get paid.
Yeah, I was just hired by Clay. He said he didn't want to really do this anymore, so he hired me to come on and be the host. So, let's do this.
Are you a DIY
guy? You went the long way for that.
Sounds like, no, actually, I just...
Yeah,
really,
you did pretty good.
I wanted a glass of water.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
It sounded really good, though. You sounded like you were from Tennessee.
Busting out all the accents today.
Yeah, I know. I can tell you're the accent guy. So, Steve, you were saying, though, you are a DIY kind of guy. So what else have you attempted to do? So you said you did some automotive stuff that instead of allowing.
Remember the TV that your mom and Uncle Neil gave me?
Mm-hmm.
Remember it was broken, and I looked up on YouTube on how to fix it.
I know these stories, Steve. You tell the stories to the guests, my friend.
Oh, okay. My bad. Okay. So,
you know, no,
show.
You know,
we're doing a like show. My bad. I forgot. Well, anyways, let's see. Rocco's mom and dad, they had a TV that just kept going out on them and everything like that. So I was wondering, like, what was going on with it. It should have been an easy fix or something like that. So I looked up on YouTube. Actually, I looked up on Google. I just typed in and said problem with this TV. And yeah, it looked like it was just having like the little transformer issue or something like that. I forgot what the thing is. Capacitor. It was a capacitor. It's one little capacitor. And they said, yeah, if you could fix it, you can have it. So all I did was buy a little $2 capacitor, took the freaking back off the TV, and put the capacitor in, and boom, it worked.
Got yourself a free $350, $400,
$500 TV. And it was like a 40-inch TV or something like that.
Just a little
tiny issue and everything. I got a good 8 months out of it. And then I guess it kept blowing capacitors, kept blowing through.
Doesn't matter. $2 fix for you for, and that's it. It was a $2 TV.
Wasn't bad. Yeah. And ended up tossing it out because it stopped working again. So
what causes you to be ideal DIY kind of guy? Like, what is it, you know, is that something you love to do? Is it a money thing, like value thing?
It's mainly for a money thing. Well, actually, I don't know. The thing is like, I've never really had a lot of money. So maybe if I did, would I still be that kind of guy? That's the weird part.
Yeah.
So like I definitely do it yourself because of money.
Yeah,
As of right now, but like,
you enjoy the learning process.
The thing is, I always said that. Well, yeah, I enjoy the learning process definitely because like, I've always wanted to be like, I don't want to be a mechanic because you're constantly dirty all the time. I can't stand dirty fingernails. I just can't. I can't stand it. But and
just
then
wear gloves.
The heat. I'm dirty. I guess you could. And then
just wear gloves.
I guess.
But I've always wanted to learn how to like do stuff in my car just so I can fix it. Like,
yeah,
I always think that's like a really good tool.
I'm right there. Great
to have.
So for DIY stuff, like I feel like one, I'm saving money, and two, I'm learning a new trade. Like Steve was kind of talking about in terms of like just learning, like for cars, for instance, learning how to do that. So like, I went and got tools to learn how to change my I thought that was pretty cool. I did it once. I probably won't do it again. Because you have to dispose the oil, and that's a whole like thing, and like it's and like it will save you money over time, but like it was also very unsafe that I realized afterwards. I was like, oh man, my car was not like, it's on a hill a little bit, and like I was using this like little ass jack, and I was like, there's stories of people getting their head crushed. Like I don't live like out in the rural area. I live in the city, so I'm like, this was not the best really environment.
Yeah.
Maybe
right in the middle
future,
of the city street, you're like changing your oil on the side of the road.
Yeah, it's just like anything, anybody comes up and bumps it, like that thing is falling over on me, and I was like, okay, I'm not.
Sounds like a movie where a little pigeon comes and just like.
I put my hand on the car and the whole thing was like, and I was like,
no.
And thank God it was done, but I was like, okay. not again.
Gotcha.
But it was cool. It was a good experience. Yeah. Right? And I think, you know, when I was growing up, my dad was definitely not a do-it-yourself guy. He liked hiring a professional to come in and get it done quickly, efficiently, and he didn't mind paying the money for it. And I respect that. But I never had to mow the lawn. I never had to, like, really do a lot of gardening. I never had to, like, work on – and, like, I also then grew up not wanting to do any of that. But I hit a point in my life where I was like, dude, I don't want to do any of this shit. Fucking, I need to learn. So I actually get really excited. Like, I had to break the frames, the window frames, screen frames, because they were just like old and cracky, and I had to make new ones. I went to Home Depot, and we actually have a very odd set of dimensions, so they don't make a pre-created one. So I had to buy the frames.
Oh, awesome!
I had to cut them with a saw. I had to measure out the screens. I had to put them in the screen with a tool that like rubs it, or, like puts it around and put the things in. Like I learned a lot.
Yeah.
It sounds so stupid to like make your own screens.
No,
it's really,
but it's
but it was
so
fun,
very cool.
Right? Like, yeah. And I saved money. I didn't have to hire someone to come in, like, or like buy.
And
like,
you learn something new. Yeah.
So
exactly.
It was cool. It was pretty cool. I like doing that.
That's cool though, because that's the same way. That's the thrill that I get out of it too. I do a lot of DIY kind of stuff too. And the reason why I do a lot of it is one, like you guys are saying, you do save money by doing it yourself. But two, I do it because there's been like just this like hunger for learning more about everything in life. Like I'm like, maybe I'm not gonna do that more than once, but who cares? Like I would like to learn how that process even works. You know what I mean? Like if somebody, like for example, there's some things that are out of my like expertise that I wouldn't even try to attempt. Like their transmission recently that blew and had to get it fixed. I wouldn't even try to attempt to repair it or do anything. I just took it to a shop to say, hey, you guys do it, who specializes in transmissions.
Yeah.
But if you're talking about like rotors being changed, you know, you're talking about like your brake pads, you're talking about like, you know, any of those things that like are pretty interchangeable and then aren't too complex, like I will definitely try to attempt to do those myself and on any type of automotive.
Yeah.
You know, on like a build it myself, you know, not taking anything away from my brother-in-law too, that also helped. But we, and Steve-O actually. But built a greenhouse, you know what I mean?
Yeah, like, dude,
built
that's it up. So cool.
Instead of going out and like buying one, there's prefab ones that are really good and they're efficient and they're awesome. They don't cost that much. We went out and did it ourselves, you know, and said we wanted to get this experience of how to do this, how to construct one. What does it take? How much does it cost? You know, can we do this on our own scale? Do we need to buy, you know, furbished one? Can we make a company out of this? Can we build greenhouses for other people and make money off of it on the weekends, which is something that we're actually going to start doing too.
That's smart.
We already have one person down the road. Now the other thing we also did with DIY is that led to like even I want to make my own food, you know, like DIY to that point, not just build it yourself, but like make it yourself too.
Right.
You know, like I want to make our own food so we'd be able to have kale and tomatoes.
I saw you posted, right? Did you get tomatoes?
And cucumber. And it was tomatoes,
And
Better Boy tomatoes and then kale.
Dude.
Blue Dwarf kale.
Fuck yeah.
So, and then eggs, right? Like chickens. We built a chicken coop. We've raised 13 chickens, do it ourselves now instead of getting eggs coming from the grocery store. And now we're getting like 10 eggs a day. Easy. They're laying in the morning and the afternoon. We have 50 eggs we just had the other day in a basket. It's like, it's awesome. And now we can even go to sell those too, where, you know, people are selling their eggs in the market for organic, you know, fresh eggs for six of them for like $3.50. And we're going to sell 12 of them for $4.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, that's awesome. Like, and we can start giving to people in that way too. So it's like,
it's really interesting.
DIY is very, very gratifying is what DIY is for me. And that's why I'm a DIY kind of guy.
Yeah.
Like, I just like the way that tagline hits. I'm a DIY.
It's pretty cool, too, because you start to see how much money people are actually charging for what would you call, I don't know what you would call it, like labor, right? Like,
labor.
If you build a computer these days, like, I can build top of the line computer for about $1,700, and you look at what that would actually cost if you went to, you know,
it's like $3,500.
Exactly.
You know,
so
like,
you're looking at how much you're actually paying that, and it makes sense. You know, they have to make a living too, but you're like, well, it's not that hard. I can learn how to do
but
it myself,
that's like
and I will save
$50 an hour, man.
Yeah,
like,
I was
come
so,
on, bro.
I was so pissed when I found out like the shitty computer I got for the money I paid. Like, I was so mad.
Oh, that's right, because you're building one as well, right, Steve?
I'm building one now, and it's gonna be like half the cost of what I paid for my shitty one. You know what I mean? Like,
It's cool too.
Half the cost. I was like,
and
I've
thought about
shit.
That too. Like, what if we could get into like building computers for people? But the problem is like, with tablets and laptops,
liability
these days,
and all that different stuff too.
Well, I mean, that's a pain because it's like they get a virus, they'll call you, right? But like, which is not your job, but like it, yeah. But I just don't know how many people are actually buying desktops these days. But it would be really cool to fucking construct computers and like ship them out for people because it's not that hard.
It's funny that you talk about that. That's one of my next projects, like on my goals, is to learn small engineering, small motherboard soldering and all that electronics. Wow.
Cool.
So I want to learn electronics and I want to learn engineering for the sake of like RC hobby kind of stuff. Like I want to start to build
cars,
drones, all these little things. I want to do that because I want to understand electronics and how they operate and work so that for whatever reason, I'm thinking larger scale for stuff like
booby traps,
aquaponics systems,
and if they,
aquaponics systems and other things like that, ways of how it all can be engineered and made it more efficient. And like, because if I understand that knowledge, it's more information I now have to work off of.
Right,
so I can go, oh, I know how that operates and works, but what if we were to try to do it this way?
Yeah.
But if I don't know, then if I never take that time to learn it, then I'll never have a clue about it. It'll never be an opportunity to make new innovations.
You should just look up on how to make a bow. That's it. You should make a bow yourself.
Yeah, but I really want the specific kind.
Bro that we play with on the game, he's been attempting to make his own recurve bow.
I know. I mean, that would definitely be a fun project.
Like recurve long bow. It's just a project he wants to do too, like a hobby like we're talking about. Just to eventually make his own bow, and then if he likes the way how it fell or with the experience of it, make a really good bows just to
sell.
Why? Because he likes that. Eventually sell, he makes some money off of it and stuff like that, but just because he likes that, you know what I mean, like working with your hands and doing something that ends up
there's this guy that I watched that he makes boomerangs. He started off making boomerangs himself, and now he makes boomerangs
in the shapes of
like superhero stuff. Like he made a batarang.
Oh, cool. That's cool.
Like, pretty cool.
That is awesome.
And I watched him on YouTube and everything like that, and he's made that. He's also made like a Sivir boomerang type thing.
No shit.
So it looks like her thing, and it legitly works. Like he knows the craft of making a boomerang, and like he can make it any size, and it'll always come back to you.
So
it's so cool.
Speaking of Sivir and League of Legends, and we'll transition out of this topic in a minute. The internationals are coming up. We need to prepare. And I want to do a stream. I would love to do a stream of as it's like the finals. It would
live.
It'd be pretty cool.
Live when we're chatting on what's kind of commentating. I gotcha.
Yeah.
For sure.
That'd be pretty cool.
Right?
Yeah.
Well, we
did.
Yeah,
I
want
have like their own like little screen.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Yeah, I kind of guys.
We're just we don't want to listen to other people commentate.
We want to commentate
over a while watching. Yeah. All right. Let's go on to our next topic. Steve-O, this is your topic.
All right, cool. I'm going to be... Did you guys see Suicide Squad yet?
No, I didn't see it. I don't plan on seeing it unless I can get it for free. All
right, good. Rocco, same thing.
I haven't seen it yet. The movie I'm planning on seeing today is going to be Alan's movie. Yeah.
Dude, I heard it's so good.
Yeah. I'm hoping
it's going to be. Who's watching the kids?
My mom is watching the kids.
Can they watch Xander?
They're coming with.
No, man.
Can she watch Xander so that Sarah and I can join you?
Yeah, for real.
Okay.
See how awesome this is going to be?
Yeah. What are you talking about? Your mom's not coming with you to Seattle.
No, but bro will be, and bro will watch the kids. So he'd be cool with it. He would absolutely be cool with it.
Well, a 7-month?
Oh, absolutely, dude. He's such a good uncle. He's really good.
If he's comfortable.
Yeah, he's been around with both of the kids like as they've been young enough, like daily.
Cool.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. All right.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Okay. All right, so expectations out of this movie were... I'd say, what do you think, guys? They're pretty high. Like,
No.
After Batman v Superman, I've heard like they've made remakes. They took a lot of deleted scenes out. They've actually added scenes in.
They hired
the movie.
Companies to make multiple edits of the movie, to have
multiple
versions of the movie, and they screen tested it with people to see which ones they liked better.
Well, they did it because after Batman v Superman, they said it was too serious, and that's kind of like what Suicide Squad was. So they even took the actors and made like new scenes to like where they
play them down a little bit.
Hey Jerry.
Well, funny parts.
Jerry, funny parts. Put up the logos of the Suicide Squad's 3 trailers, and it will show the difference of the colors. Like it starts out really gloom and doom. It's just like black and gunmetal, and then it gets a little bit more colorful. And by the third one, it's like really. Right down there, Jerry. Just put it right over Rocco's face. We'll look at it. Yeah. So you can see that, like, even to Steve.
Did you call for Jerry to do this?
Yeah. Yeah, Jerry. Yeah.
Dude, Jerry. We
okay,
just hired
Jerry,
him.
Thank you, Jerry.
He's our editor. Yeah, he's gonna edit our stuff now.
Oh. So. Appreciate you, Jerry.
Yeah, thanks, Jerry. Yeah. So you can see that it gets like a
this
lot
is
more.
Real? Cause I got
it got a lot more colorful, right? So like they definitely are trying to change the vibe. Look, when you're the top 10 iTunes podcast, you start to get a little bit of recognition, and people want to help
that's
you.
Thank
right?
you, Jerry.
Appreciate so, you. I like
look,
Jerry.
Jerry. Thank you.
It's
for...
funny because that's my dad's name.
Well, yeah. I hope that doesn't. Okay, so
appreciate
we have so Suicide Squad. So yeah, they definitely tried they realized from the beginning, I think, that they were getting backlash. Like the costumes, there was like a lot of backlash to the costumes. There was a lot of backlash into like how serious it was looking, and like they were like, okay. And then Batman v Superman, right, like you said, like came out, and they're like, people really don't like this grittiness. It's too doom and gloom. Let's make it like Guardians of the Galaxy. Hey. Guardians of the Galaxy was just like this, right? It was a bunch of different people had to like band together and like do a thing, and you know what? They were like really flashy and colorful, and that soundtrack, like, it was really successful. It was all 80s and stuff. Let's throw in a soundtrack. Like, so they hired this like this amazing and talented trailer company that cuts trailers, and they threw and they basically just like
they did really good with the trailers.
Yeah, they made the trailers look like just it's like the have you guys ever heard of syncopation? The term syncopation,
it synchronizes a song with everything that goes with the movie, right?
No, but that's kind of what.
But they pretty much did that with the Bohemian Rap shading.
Yeah, but so syncopation is like a way to create music, and it generates naturally in your brain to like bob and head and move it, and like it makes you feel good, and like and it's just the way that it all the different like tunes harmonize, right? So they did that with the trailer. Yeah, and they did that with the trailer, yep. And it's like you just naturally are like, wow, this makes you feel good, and I'm like, I'm down with it, and that's great. But
it's Bohemian Rhapsody.
Yeah, and so it's kind of a cop out because there's no representation of that actual movie. But what they did is the edit that went live, where what people saw was it was edited and cut by that trailer company, and not the director and his people. So he has a different version of that movie that exists.
Like a lot of the stuff that you saw in the trailer wasn't in the movie.
Right.
Oh,
like
really?
They cut a lot of those scenes out. As far as like, I mean, I don't know, because based on the critics hated it. People did like it. I guess it got a 71% on Rotten Tomatoes,
which
is pretty good. It's like I said, I didn't really expect anything from it. Like, it really seems like they tried a little too hard, because like they I know Joker and Harley Quinn's relationship in the animated series was abusive. You know, like the Joker was abusive to Harley Quinn, and Harley Quinn kept going back to her. And they tried to portray that in the actual movie. But the thing is, they took all those scenes out because they said it was too serious.
They said, okay, so I was listening to someone, and apparently, sorry, Steve, but real quick on that note, apparently, just to help Rocco get context, there was a scene where Joker pushes Harley Quinn out of the helicopter to kill her, and it actually, like, he does it, but they edit it in a way that instead of it looking like that,
it looks like
he saved her.
Yeah, it looks like he saved her, and I actually watched it twice.
Really?
I watched it twice. Yeah, the first time was with Amber, and then the second time was with my daughter last night, because she really wanted to see it. She didn't know I seen the movie.
Okay.
So I wanted to just do something with me and her.
Because Harley Quinn?
Yeah, she liked Harley Quinn and everything. So so I saw it twice, but the thing was is it didn't look like he pushed her out. They were about to both go out of the helicopter. He's like, it's you and me, baby. And then they are both about to jump out. And like the helicopter exploded, and he kind of fell backwards, and he was reaching out for her, and she fell the other way. So like, it didn't portray that at all. Like he pushed her at all to save her. Like he was about to go out with her, and then like he fell backwards, and she fell out the other way. So it's kind of like that. But the thing was, dude, is it seemed too cheesy. The way they put the funny stuff inside the movie, like they were trying too hard to make it like.
Because it was an afterthought.
It seemed like it was too forced. Like even some of, I don't know too much about Deadshot, but like it seemed like his lines were just so stupid.
That's
Will Smith couldn't even make him up. Because like one of the lines was like, I'm going to come. He's like, you know, when I get out of here, I'm going to get out of here someday. He's like, and I'm going to rain down on you on whole something. He's like the Holy Ghost. That's what he says. I'm going to rain down on you like the Holy Ghost. And, like, that didn't sound badass at all to me, you know what I mean? Like, at all, I was like, that is, you could have said something else, like, you know what I mean? Like, he's cussing the entire movie, pretty much. And he says, I'm going to rain down on you like the unholy ghost. Like, and then in one part of the movie, he also says to you, he's like, you know, we're going to go get you. He's like, I'm going to take you there. He's like, and it's going to be, and my daughter's going to know I'm a hero. And it's going to be like a chapter in the Bible.
Jesus, and I didn't know Deadshot was so Christian.
Like, that's what I'm saying. Like, he was like, it was just seemed so forced, and it didn't seem like badass at all. Like, and seeing some of the funny quips, like you know, like you used to see him with like Tony Stark and stuff like that. I guess Harley Quinn was supposed to be like that kind of person.
Yeah.
Along with Captain Boomerang.
Yeah.
Like, they're supposed to go back and forth and everything. And some of the parts were pretty funny, but like as far as like the Harley Quinn parts, it seemed kind of forced.
Did you laugh out loud at all?
The crocodile guy definitely made me laugh. Tampa, Florida, apparently.
Oh,
he's
okay.
From Tampa, Florida. But he's like a gangster, so like he didn't talk pretty much the entire movie, but when he did, it was pretty funny.
Okay.
So I mean, I don't know, like my expectations were pretty much like after Batman v Superman, where it was just like it was just gonna be like even for the new one, man, like the Justice League, I'm not really excited about that at all. I don't like the way the costumes look. I don't like the way characters look. I don't watch the WB stuff though. Like, I don't know if you're excited at all for it, or do you have any expectations for this movie too?
I'm more excited about Justice League than I am over the other ones, because I can see the ship starting to turn, and so I'm excited of the potential. But they are ultimately like WB is so in the trenches and hands on with their shit that I am very confident that they will find a way to screw up Justice League, because they're just gonna have too much but that movie that just made a bunch of $1 billion, we gotta put that element in there, and they don't understand why the element was created or how it like threads into like the other thing, like the whole soundtrack thing for Suicide Squad. Like, they thought in their head Guardians of the Galaxy was successful because they had this like poppy music, but Star-Lord was born in the 80s, and the only thing that he has to remind himself of his dead mother and Earth is his soundtrack, and his soundtrack was given to him by his mother, and she was an 80s fan, so it made
sense.
There's
an understood intent behind it. Yeah,
so like, it made sense why it existed. There's no reason why Bohemian Rhapsody is in Suicide Squad. There's just no there's no connection there.
And I just want to let you know that Bohemian Rhapsody was not in it was only in the trailer.
But
it was only in the trailer.
Music like that apparently in the opening. Like, you open up with a song like that or something that's like...
Okay, I just want to let you know too that Heathens... that the portrayal inside that thing and Sucker for Pain, you know, that, you know, I'm just a sucker for... All right, so, and Heathens from 21 Pilots did not play at all during the whole entire movie until the end, the credits. That was it.
But wasn't there a pop song that played in the very beginning? I thought I heard that. Like, the opening is very, like, it's a
yeah,
song.
Yeah, I forgot what it was. It was a really good pop song. I forgot. Dang it, what was it?
Britney Spears, Oops, I Did It Again, right?
Yeah, yeah, it was
did it again.
A major
bang, bang.
Movie dark.
Bang,
I
bang.
Edited it, shit.
Bang, bang. Ooh, baby, yeah. You gonna get a...
Oh, there we go.
New film.
Yeah, this is great.
That's not the same.
Oh, Jesus. Yeah, so like... Okay, keep going, Steve. This is fascinating. I'm really like, you're doing a great job.
Sad Squad.
Yeah, I'm just I mean, other parts in the movie, like they just were showing like Harley Quinn's ass the entire time, pretty much.
That's why I sighed when your daughter wanted to go see, because it's like, man, because Harley Quinn is actually a really cool character, but they just Margot Robbie, they're like, oh yeah, she did that thing in Wolf of Wall Street where she's really sexy. Let's add that element to Harley Quinn. It's like Harley Quinn doesn't walk around showing. Presenting herself to people. This is crazy. She's in like a freaking onesie pajama for the most part. Why did you do
that?
Like, women are going to look at this character and want to like be represented by that. Like, that sucks, man.
Yeah.
Right. And I mean, I don't know. Like, but I think my daughter, she's at a maturity level where she
can handle.
You know, she can understand that stuff. Like, that's, I mean, good. Like, I said, do you want to go see Sasha's Party? And she was like, no, that's an inappropriate movie for me. I definitely don't want to see that. That's what she said.
That's
I was
cool.
Like, I don't know if I believe her, but I thought it was pretty funny. I wasn't going to go take her to see it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was just like, but yeah, see, any excuse for that, like, she was like, it was just unnecessary. Like, some of the parts in the movie, like, what she was just doing, it was just like, they did it like three times. Like, and she was just like, what? Come on, guys, let's go. Like, it was just like, that was just it. You know what I mean? Like, that was an unnecessary part of the movie. You didn't really know. Like, we get it.
With her character. She doesn't do that. Like, that's not a thing. Yeah. She's not a sex vixen. She's
and the thing was, like, I don't want to ruin it for you, but
I'm not going to watch it.
Okay, but you know that Captain, like, the slingshot guy?
Captain Boomerang?
Like, not Captain Boomerang. There's another guy whose name's Slingshot. Captain Flat. Basically, he can climb anything. I forgot about like that. He's an actual character in a DC comic. So, like, he's an old character.
His name's Slingshot?
I think it's Slingshot.
What was
but anyways, I forgot his name. Okay. Dang it. Suicide Squad. But anyways, he gets killed, like, right off the fucking bat. Yeah. Like, they put him in there just basically to get killed.
Yeah.
But apparently, I guess he was supposed to be, like, a rapist or something like that. So, like, they wanted to not feel sympathetic for him or something like that. So, like, people wouldn't miss him.
Yeah, sure.
But, like, I didn't really connect with any character during that movie. Maybe Deadshot a little bit, just because he has a daughter in the movie and everything like that. And, you know, he's just trying to be a dad. And they're just trying to portray the entire movie that these guys are people, too.
They're just misunderstood, for sure.
They're just misunderstood. But, like, the thing is, like, I don't know. Like, Harley Quinn's supposed to be, like, crazy. And she is kind of crazy in the movie, but she's not as crazy as, like, I thought she would be, like, as, like, the Joker. She's supposed to be on Joker's level, isn't she? Pretty much.
She's a little bit insane, but not on Joker's level. She's in love with Joker. She's got a very Stockholm Syndrome-esque mentality to Joker. And she is the quintessential girl who's in love with an abusive boyfriend and at times will leave. But she will go back to him, and you're like, dude, what are you doing? He's the guy that, like, is hitting you. But he's got all my DVDs. It's just, I'll just stay with him for a little bit longer. I don't want to go through that process. You're like, all right, whatever. So, I mean, yeah, I mean, she's kind of crazy, but she's not as crazy as Joker. Like, she's not, I don't know. She doesn't have anywhere near the amount of stories that have Joker killing people or, like, stabbing or, like, brutally hurting or, you know. But she's a villain, sure.
I'm trying to think of other parts of the movie, like,
well, Joker, for instance, I don't think had a point, right? Is what I'm understanding. He's like,
no, there was no point. He basically filled in the gaps in the movie, pretty much. He probably had a total of maybe 15 minutes of FaceTime. Not even, I'd say like 12 minutes of FaceTime during the whole entire movie.
Yeah.
That's how it's presented in that.
And the other thing too was like, they didn't really know what to do with all those characters. Like, they had all these characters, and they're, like, trying to think, what do they put them up against, pretty much? And it's like, all right, you got Harley Quinn, who is supposed to, because they're all talking about metahumans, basically. Mm-hmm. It's almost like mutants for, like, X-Men, but they're called metahumans.
Yeah.
So, like, I'm sitting there thinking, I'm like, okay, Deadshot, is he really a metahuman, or is he just a really good shooter? I'm also thinking, like, Captain Boomerang, like, okay, he's good with boomerangs, but is he really a metahuman? Like, you know what I mean?
None of them are metahumans. Maybe the flame guy is.
The katana. Yeah, he's a metahuman. Yeah. Definitely a metahuman. The katana girl, like, her sword's metahuman, I guess, because it's still souls or something.
No,
like
it's
that.
Just magic. It's just magic.
Yeah, it's just a magic thing. And then, like, who was that? The Croc, Killer Croc. He has super strength.
Yeah, he's a metahuman. So
he's definitely a metahuman.
Yeah.
But, like, as far as the rest of them, no, they're not metahumans at all. Like, even Batman, he's not a fucking metahuman either.
Metahumans, like, Flash.
So, like, yeah, I don't know. But I definitely say that the beginning was definitely enjoyable than the end. Like, it's when it got on the action sequences and everything like that, like, I was just like, ugh. And then it was, like, followed, like, by long pauses and telling histories and their backstory and then, like, just unnecessary shit, you know what I mean? Like, it was just, I don't know how to explain.
That's a really good review, though. Like, that's a very thorough review.
Yeah, man.
of that movie.
I mean, I don't know, but the thing is, like, If they didn't delete all those scenes or anything like that and made it more enjoyable for the public, would it have been the same? Like, no, would they enjoy it? You think?
I don't know. I'm really interested to see what his cut would have been. The director's cut.
The other cut looks like the more gloomy feel.
It was gonna be more gloomy and dark because, like, apparently the Joker was abusive and, like, you know, slapped Harley Quinn. But that was mainly. He did that in the story. Like, so I actually watched a lot of the, like, Harley Quinn and Joker's backstory. And everything like that, and he was abusive. Like, at one point, he tried to kill her a bunch of times, and even tried to. And, like, Harley Quinn ended up actually joining with Batman, and then later, like, joined up with Poison Ivy, and they tried to kill Batman and Joker.
Yeah.
But he kept going back to Joker, and then at one point Joker was gonna slice her throat in front of Batman, and Batman's at saver it again, and then Harley Quinn shoots her shoulder and stuff like that. So
I think a lot of people know this, but just in case they don't, Harley Quinn was actually created for the Batman animated series. She's a completely new character, and
in 97 or 95, right?
Yeah, and then I mean she got so popular that they put her in the comics, but like a lot of her origin story actually comes from, unlike most comic book characters, the comics comes from the cartoon. So it's kind of cool to see that. She had a lot of those moments where she would team up with Batman because she was sick of Joker shit, but then she would ultimately always just fall in love with him again and go back.
But the cool thing was about it too was that people, like some of the Justice League, made cameos inside there. Yeah. Just for a second, though. Yeah. Like I think the Flash was in there, and then Batman pretty much was in there, everything like that. And they even, like, it showed Batman, like, meeting up with Amanda Waller, and, like, getting, like, you know, like, the top secret plans, like, of metahumans, and that's how, like, he started looking for the Justice League and everything, so.
But he already has that. Like, that's what I was understanding, too, is that there's a lot of repetitive scenes. He already has a folder.
Why would he need to go to her? That's what I'm saying. Why would he need to go there? Yeah. Like, and talk to her? So I don't know why they added that in. I guess they wanted to, like, rival Marvel, you know, like, because they have, like, a thing to go on to the next scene, you know, like, at the end of the movie.
Well, they originally said they weren't going to do stuff like that, to be different.
Yeah. And the crazy thing was Samuel L. Jackson kinda, like, just popped up in there, too.
And he was like, yo, I want to recruit you guys for the initiative.
Yeah, exactly. But, yeah, I mean, that's pretty much, like, all I have to really say about the movie. I don't know what could have made it better, though. Like,
not produced by WB.
I guess, yeah, because when I saw WB, like, at the top, I'm like, this is kind of crazy. I definitely like the soundtrack and everything. That was awesome. I don't know.
I mean, those songs are good alone.
I really wanted them to take this out, like, you know, like, to take it home, pretty much.
Be more serious, but yeah.
Not be more serious, but, like, I want to get excited about it, like another, you know, superhero movies.
I will say this. Like, I'm sad about the fact that it's making money, but Batman v Superman made a lot of money too, and they at least acknowledge the fact that they messed up, and they're trying to course correct by getting Geoff Johns in as the new director and VP of the DC Entertainment Universe, Marvel or movie universe, and they're getting rid of Zack Snyder in that sense. So they're trying to course correct, but
are they doing kind of like, remember, like when before Marvel was involved in any of, like, the superhero movies, they were kind of shit a little bit. Why don't they do the same thing that Marvel did? Like,
I'll be right back.
Like DC gets involved with. You know what I mean? Like,
that's it.
Like,
that's what they're making. So that's kind of what
that's what they're doing now,
in
right?
In a sense, they're getting Geoff Johns. But the thing is, WB owns DC. It'd be as if Disney was getting their hands in Marvel shit and being like, "No, we need to sell
a toy." Disney has
a lot
more movies. So, our money. That's a lot more money.
Well, I mean, they have the same amount of money. The only difference is that their managing styles are different. They own this company, but they trust Marvel to do their thing, and they're letting them do their thing. WB owns DC, and it sounds like they don't trust or have a problem with, like, allowing them to do the thing. So they're like, well, you're going to have to make
but
it like
the,
this,
the
and
thing
we're going to change it.
If they're so, like, you know how, like, they were saying, like, they're worried about and they're appeasing, and they even went back and tried to change stuff like that. If they're so into the research and everything like that, why don't they see what Marvel did before? And what, like, not what Marvel did before, but, like, learn from their mistakes. Like, just let trust in, like, DC or something like that.
Well,
you know what I mean?
Kind of
like Disney did with Marvel, right?
You're saying trust that the people who are running DC could run their movie? Why don't?
Well, kind of like, well, you said, like, what's his name? Like,
Geoff Johns
is coming in. Geoff Johnson. Like, is he, like, the creator of DC?
He's one of the lead editors in DC Comics. Or was is, so he knows a ton of shit about it. I mean they're giving him more power to run it. So what was your original question? Why don't they do what?
Why don't they learn from, like? Well, I mean, obviously they're learning now, but, like, mm-hmm. before all this started, like, why didn't they learn from the mistake? Because, I mean, now we're never gonna get the right Batman v Superman movie.
Yeah.
We're never gonna get the right Suicide Squad.
Yep.
So, like, I mean, what next movie? Wonder Woman looked pretty good.
Yeah.
I mean,
Alan made some good points, like, as to why it might not be that good, but yeah.
I mean, she's facing against humans, so it's like she doesn't face anything that's really stronger than
possibly,
her.
Possibly, yeah.
You know what I mean? I mean, possibly, yeah, like you're saying, but.
Yeah, so I agree. Why don't they? It seems that simple, right? Like, why don't they just, they want to be different? They misunderstand why Marvel's Avengers work. They feel like they can skip those years of movies that they created and they can go right to Justice League, right? They're playing a little bit of catch up. Marvel is treating their medium from where it came, which is to treat it like a comic book serialized medium, and it's working. DC has treated their movies like movies and trilogies and ending there, like the Nolan movies. And while those movies as a movie, like trilogy, is great, there is a disconnect in the sense that it just doesn't fit with a superhero mythos. Batman doesn't retire. He hasn't ever, like, he's still going, and it's been like, you know, almost like a century, 100 years. It just doesn't happen. That you don't conclude a superhero story. Just like, you can't cap these superhero movies. They just keep going, right? So
yeah, I know. Look at The Simpsons.
Yeah. So Marvel understands their product. Marvel understands their characters. Marvel understands what, like, makes all those, like, creative directions tick. And
yeah, kind of like WB goes back doesn't. To like the things like DC was before Marvel. Yeah, but Marvel made it better.
I think in a lot of ways. It's just a shame. I really hope they can course correct, because I want to see great movies. I want to see a great Justice League. I like those characters.
It really is. But the thing is, I followed Marvel a lot more than I did DC. So I'm like, I don't know what to really expect. Like, I'm watching these movies. And I'm like, is DC really like this? Like,
well, you know what Batman is. You know that he doesn't, like, maliciously, like, kill people.
I never really watched the Justice League though. Like,
and you know, I'm like, Superman is it really is? You know, he's not that, like, gloomy. He's more happy.
Yeah, I know he's
not. And you know, Lex Luthor is not a crazy little, like, twerp. He's more of, like, a very masculine...
Yeah, like...
So you know that they're just kind of changing their characters around and giving them weird motivations or lack thereof, and it's resulting in a very, like, convoluted, questionable mess, right? You're just like...
Think about Deadpool. Like they gave them complete creative control over that and,
fucking
like...
nailed it.
They fucking nailed it. Yeah. You know what I mean? Because that's exactly what people love. Like, the majority of people are going to see this, like... movie is going to be like comic people, like nerds, like people that know the characters and stuff like that. So that's the same thing that DC, like, you want to go see that movie, Batman. I mean, you know what I mean? You want to go see that character. You want to see what you know from the comics, right, from the animated series and everything like that.
Yeah.
You don't give a shit about anybody else. And if it's good and you guys approve of it, it's just going to keep getting money. Because, like, some people have seen that movie, like, 3-4 times or something like that. You know what I mean?
I mean, yeah, Deadpool made the most
and
money.
Gonna make. And I'm like, I'm guaranteed Batman v Superman, people, they didn't make a lot on those DVD sales at all. I mean, they tried to, like, did you see what they tried to do with that?
The Ultimate Edition? That's like an hour longer.
Yeah, it's hour longer, and they, like, said it was better, this version, something like that. And I'm like, I'm not falling for that shit.
And I think that's what they realize. I think that, like, so a lot of fanboys are saying, well, but look, it's making a ton of money. It was successful. We're fine. They're going to keep making. But I think WB realizes that there's going to be a lot of people like you, Steve, who get burned by going, being like, whoa, Batman and Superman, I'll see it. And I was like, that wasn't that good. And it's like, well, but this is Ultimate Edition is great. It's like, I'm not going to fall for that. I'm going to not watch this again. You've watched Suicide Squad now. This might – you've gotten burned again now. So
yeah.
Man of Steel, Batman v Superman, Suicide Squad, like, what are the chances? Yeah, what are the chances you actually go into the theater and watch a Wonder Woman or a Justice League or an Aquaman?
Right?
Like, I think there's going
to
be a lot of people
Amber
like you.
Wants to. Yeah.
And if that happens, they might be forced to honestly burn the whole thing down and start over again.
I mean, it looks good. It looks good, but I don't want to. Like, I don't feel the need to.
All the Suicide Squad talk made me have to take a number two.
Oh snap!
Yeah. On the movie.
On that note. let's dump this topic and go on to the next topic. This will be my topic and the final topic. We're gonna see. Okay, so Sarah and I recently found a great YouTube channel that highlighted, like, the era defined, like, 90s defining music videos, and, you know, what made 90s great, or like top 90s, like, pop songs, rap songs, all this good stuff, and it really got me nostalgia for 90s. And then Raku comes on this podcast, and he's got these, like, crazy cool zebra silver striped glasses with this, like, blue tint. I'm like, dude, that's so 90s. I saw the sign, opened up my eyes, or something like that. Pretty sure there,
it opened up my eyes. I saw
that
the
he's
sign.
Wearing, like, tinted glasses. Anyone who knows the 90s knows that that's very 90s glasses. So I decided that it would be a great idea to do a 90s quiz where there is no loser. We're going to, well, unless we all lose, right? But we're going to collectively work together to see, you know, what it is. So the way I'd like to do this is assign you guys each a question, and then you're going to answer it.
Oh, dabs it.
We, the other people dabs. Are not answering it. We can say yes or no, we agree. But
agreed, no, yes.
It's kind of up to the person. And then we're collectively like get the score and see how well we did. All right. So I'm going to start with Steve, and I'm just going to work my way around.
B.
First question. Which album sold more records, Alanis Morissette's Jagged Little Pill or Spice Girls' Spice?
Spice Girls.
Yeah, I would
Spice.
Cool. All right.
Yeah, they were. I guess I disagree. I can be like, no.
You disagree? I agree with
maybe.
Spice
can
Girls say, were like everybody.
They're huge. They're international.
Oh yeah, they have fucking movie. Yeah. Alanis Morissette didn't have a movie.
Yeah, that's
do I get to put my input or no?
That's a really good point. What?
Do I get to put my input? No.
Yeah, this you can put an input, but Steve is the ultimate decider.
I think Alanis Morissette did better.
Okay. All right. Well, you can answer.
Oh, you said you did better. I thought you said you sold.
Yeah, it's more, sold, more. Sold more.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. So.
Yeah, I mean, I like
Rocco, which movie won the 1998 Oscar for Best Original Screenplay?
Hey, we get to figure out what like what.
No, we're gonna tally it up at the end. This is a quiz.
It's fuck!
Damn it, dude.
Okay.
Which movie won the 1998 Oscar for Best Original Screenplay? Titanic or Good Will Hunting?
Oh, that's easy.
I think
what
they,
year?
They both. Yeah, 1998.
This is a tough one, actually.
I think.
Yeah.
Was that not even? I guess it came out around the same.
Because I can't put my.
I think they both did too.
Is like, this a competition? Like
this is really good. Okay, let's just go with the Titanic on that one. Then.
I was gonna say Titanic won a lot of awards, but Good Will Hunting was very poetic.
I thought I saw awards on the front of my DVD package for Good Will Hunting too, though. So that's why I am confused here. So I'm gonna say Titanic, though.
I'm gonna disagree. I think that Titanic was a fantabulous movie, but I think it had a shitty screenplay. I also think that Titanic didn't come out in like 96, 97. I think Good Will Hunting was later. But we're going to go with Titanic because that's what we put. But that's my thought.
Okay.
What event became known as the whack herd around the world? The physical altercation between Steven and Irene on MTV's The Real World? The attack on figure skater Nancy Kerrigan?
It was called the what of the world?
The whack herd around the world.
That's for Steve-O, right?
No, it's for me. It's for me. I'm going to say it's The Real World, MTV's World. Because you guys remember he, like, slapped her?
Nope.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I remember.
I'm going to go with that.
I remember that more than I remember the. I don't even know who Nancy Kerrigan is.
She was the ice skater. She, like, the girl came out and just, like, whacked her.
With ice skate?
Yeah, no, with a crowbar.
Because I've heard that, too.
With a crowbar.
Hit her with a crowbar?
Yeah, in the knee. Dude, there's a Netflix
documentary. Where was I when this all happened?
I think I would know. I would have heard about it. I mean, I've heard the MTV one.
Yeah.
But I haven't heard that one.
All right, Steve. What is Courtney Love's real birth name? Courtney Michelle Harrison or Michelle Love?
I would say Courtney Michelle Harrison.
That sounds more generic, right? I'd agree with that. Steve or Rocco?
I'm just thinking, like, she might have used part of her middle name incorporated into, like, her stage name. I don't know. It's like, do you go with just the plain kind of sound? What was the second choice? It was what Love? Michelle Love?
Yeah.
And her name's Courtney Love right now?
Yeah. So is it Courtney Michelle Love?
Steve, I would go with
Courtney
that one.
Michelle Harrison. So that's what we're doing, but
you just switched up her first name.
Tamagotchi is a Japanese portmanteau of what two words? I don't even what is a portmanteau? A portmanteau words.
Is that
egg and
Tamagotchi is supposed to be like pocket monster or something like that.
Well, okay, so that's the question. Is it egg and watch or egg and computer?
Egg and watch.
I think it's egg and watch too. Yeah, but Rocco, this is your call.
I had like
no, I would go egg and watch.
Yeah.
Oh, this was mine?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
What is the name of the house cat, aka Christina Ricci, moves? What is the name of the house cat, aka Christina Ricci, moves into in the 95 movie Casper? Whipstaff Manor, Blackington Manor.
Oh my gosh.
I think
that's you, though.
Yeah, that's me. I think.
Oh no, my camera.
I think.
That's a tough one.
I think.
I don't remember the name there.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to call you guys back real quick.
Okay. Yep. I think it's Whipstaff. I don't think it's Blackington. That just doesn't sound like.
I'm trying to like go into my memory database and see if I can like remember what that name is.
I honestly don't. Whipstaff just.
I lost the question.
Whipstaff.
Oh, what is the name of the house that cat moves into in the 95 movie Casper? Who's played by Christina Ricci? What is the house that the movie takes place
in
that she moved into.
Yeah,
in yeah.
95.
And did you already say it? Because I know this one.
Oh, it's Whipstaff Manor or Blackington Manor.
Whipstaff Manor.
That's what I thought. Yeah. Okay. We're gonna go with
that. We all went that. I think you just listened to us and you just.
What was
that
the
out there.
What was the name of?
I didn't hear you.
Steve, this is for you. What is the name of the judge who presided over the O.J. Simpson murder trial? Cato or Ido?
Neither. I'm going to say Judge Cato. That sounds better.
Yeah, for whatever.
I like Cato, too. That's,
okay,
yeah,
let's go Cato.
Let's go that word, that name.
Okay, what was the name of the sheep who was the first successfully cloned animal in 96? Molly or Dolly?
Molly.
No. I think I'm pretty sure it's Dolly.
It was Dolly?
I'm almost positive. No, it's your call, but I'm almost positive it's Dolly.
All right, you go with Dolly. I'm going to go with Molly.
All right, well,
Molly, you just want Molly because it's a drug.
We'll go with Molly. I mean, no, this is your call, but
I went with Molly because I'm pretty sure I thought the name
Dolly the sheep.
It was the sheep, right?
Yeah.
It was Molly the sheep or Dolly the sheep. I don't remember it being Dolly. Okay. All right.
What does the acronym JNCO, the brand name of their gargantuan gene, stand for?
Janko.
Yeah. Judge none, choose one. Journey now, carry on.
Journey now, carry on.
Really?
I would go with that. They're pants,
actually, wait,
right?
Judge, you said
judge
what?
None, choose one? That doesn't really make
sense. I'm
going to
say judge none, choose one.
Really?
Well, maybe because, like, you remember Janko jeans?
Yeah.
You remember those?
Yeah,
were, like,
really
they were, like,
jeans?
Fucking baggy-ass jeans.
Yeah.
I remember everyone wanted because they had,
like tons of pockets and everything.
Yeah, so maybe judge none would be a good slogan because, like,
But choose one? That's where I'm falling off. I don't understand that.
I'm
going to go with my first
journey.
Journey
now, carry
I'm
on.
Go
I think that's more of a
jeans
thing.
You're, like, moving, walking, you're journeying.
Totally. All right, Steve. Who was not a member of the Mickey Mouse Club? Kerry Russell or Jessica Simpson?
Kerry Russell. No, Jessica Simpson.
I think it was Jessica Simpson,
You can't change
them
up.
Because, Britney Spears, Justin Timberlake. I think even at one point, it was Christina Aguilera.
Yep.
Yeah, I don't think Jessica Simpson was in there, was she?
No.
They had a bunch of people that were in there at one point. No, I don't think Jessica Simpson wasn't in there.
No, I don't think she was.
What was the flavor of the soft drink Surge?
She's younger.
Rocco, this is for you. Citrus or pineapple?
Citrus.
I mean, I will believe you.
I haven't tried Surge.
Oh, Surge?
Yeah.
Wait, Surge?
Yeah.
Would you say what was the flavor?
Yeah, citrus or pineapple?
It was citrus.
Okay.
It was citrus.
Okay.
Yeah.
Who was this is for me. Who was the creator of Dawson's Creek? J.J. Abrams or Kevin Williamson?
Kevin.
It has to be. It can't be J.J. Abrams. There's no
way. No, because he's too young. He's way too young.
Yeah, there's no way.
Yeah.
But if that's true, my mind is going to be blown.
Yeah, he did it when he was five.
Yeah.
That's why he's so famous.
Yeah.
So I was like...
All right, Steve, what was the title of Madonna's controversial 1992 book? Erotica or Sex?
I'm going to say, like, with her... I'm going to say Sex.
Mm. I'm going Erotica.
Yeah, that's what
Erotica.
I think. Yeah.
I was gonna say, I'm trying to think of her because she was like...
It's your call.
She didn't give a shit. Okay, Erotica. We'll go to Erotica then.
What complication was Y2K based on? Rocco, this is for you. At midnight, all computers reset to the year 0000, or computers would interpret the year 2000 as 1900?
The first one.
I disagree. I think it's the second one. But we'll go with the first one. Okay. Which band formed first, NSYNC or the Backstreet Boys?
Backstreet Boys. Because they're a lot older.
Yeah.
I would go with the Backstreet Boys too. I believe they came out first.
The Hellmouth was a supernatural portal on which 90s TV show? Charmed or Buffy the Vampire Slayer?
Ooh.
What was the portal called again?
Hellmouth.
This is me, right?
Hellmouth.
No, this is Steve-O.
The thing is.
Steve-O? This is Steve-O?
I've watched both of these.
I know. I'm pretty sure it's Buffy.
The thing I've never heard that in Buffy.
They've
the
had portals before.
But they
Charm
have
much
portals,
more portals.
Charm has a lot more portals.
Yeah.
The thing is, I've watched.
We're talking about
no,
TV
there is
show has more portals.
I watched Buffy the Vampire.
There is more portals in Charmed.
Because a girl in high school I liked.
It's funny
she
that
liked
we know
the
that.
Show, and I wanted to watch the show to be able to talk to her.
Steve, you don't have to make excuses on this. You just have to answer.
Yeah. No, I'm serious. So I'm
no,
gonna say
don't make excuses. Okay. We all watched Charmed.
I don't remember that.
Who wrote the book The Firm in 1991? Stephen King, this is for you, Rocco, or John Grisham?
John Grisham did.
Okay. Is this?
Yep.
Oh,
I just felt confident there. I was like, yeah.
Yeah, John.
We're going with that one. C. I'll
okay.
take C.
Okay. Okay. One second
Option
here.
Option three.
Oh, I can't.
Damn. Jerry, just edit this out real quick.
Jerry, yeah, edit this. Yeah, I'm trying to share screens here. Yeah, okay. Is this Beavis or Butthead?
That is who is this for right now? Near you.
Butthead.
This is for me. Is this Beavis or
Butthead? That's definitely Butthead.
Okay.
That is definitely Butthead. Click on that.
Okay.
Hit Butthead.
Okay.
There.
I gotta. Oh God. Now I gotta stop sharing.
No, stop sharing.
Okay, here we
Hit
go.
Butthead.
There we go. All right, it's Butthead. It's Butthead.
Okay. Yeah, it's definitely Butthead.
Rocko's Modern Life.
This is for you, Steve-O. Rocko of the Nickelodeon animated series and Rocko's favorite animated series, Rocko's Modern Life, was what kind of animal? A wallaby? Or a mixed breed dog?
It was a wallaby.
Okay.
Oh, by the way, just a little tidbit. They're actually relaunching the show.
I heard.
You heard about that? Yeah.
I did. I was like, oh, gosh.
Maybe, Rocko, you'll appreciate this show. Because it was a good show. Rocko, this is for you. What was the name of the Pentagon employee who secretly recorded phone conversations with Monica Lewinsky in which she talked about her affair with Bill Clinton? Was it Paula Jones or Linda Tripp?
Paula Jones.
You were reading an article on this.
Paula Jones is definitely who did that one.
I was going to say Linda Tripp, but okay.
No, Miss Jones. I remember Miss Jones.
She's trippy if she's going to do that, man.
Which was the highest grossing movie of the 90s, Titanic or Jurassic Park?
Oh, Titanic. That was everywhere. Yeah. High grossing, like just in the U.S. or just everywhere?
I guess.
That one's for Clay, though.
Oh, yeah, my bad.
I think Titanic, honestly. I mean, there's a reason why. I mean, it still holds the number one record today. So.
Yeah.
Steven's a cut line kind of guy.
Steve, this one's for you.
Tell that.
Which future?
Yeah, because it goes Passions of the Christ and then it goes Titanic, pretty much, I think.
Oh, Jesus. Which future Oscar winner starred on Beverly Hills 90210? Charlize Theron or Hilary Swank? Man, I didn't know any of that.
I'm gonna say Hilary Swank because I don't think Charlize Theron was in that at all.
Rocko, what was the name of the prostitute who Hugh Grant got caught with? Alex Diamond or Divine Brown?
Divine sounds like a prostitute name.
Yeah. Alex Diamond sounds
one. Both very.
Oh, that actually sounds. Yeah.
Which film Diamond. Was first ever animated movie to be nominated for an Academy Award for Best Picture? Beauty and the Beast or Lion King?
Is that me?
It's me. I'm gonna say Lion King. There's a reason.
I
why
would
they
go
made
with that.
A Broadway
yeah.
play, right? Who sang the Friends theme song, Steve? The Rembrandts or Gin Blossoms?
The Rembrandts.
Yeah, I'm gonna go with that one as well.
Gin Blossoms, the girl.
Rocko, what event did Michael Jackson have on stage kiss with his then wife Lisa Marie Presley? At what event did he have this kiss? The 94 MTV VMAs or the 94 Grammys?
I said
the 94 VMAs.
I would agree. It's very much an MTV thing to do. In 97, who became the first woman to be appointed at the Secretary of State in the United States? Madeleine Albright or Janet Reno?
What was that one again?
In 97, who became the first woman to be appointed as the Secretary of State in the United States? Was it Janet Reno or was it Madeleine Albright? I think it's Janet Reno.
I'm going to say Janet Reno to you. I wasn't going to say anything. Cause
sounds like a strong name.
No, it's Janet Reno.
Clueless, Steve-O, is loosely based on which Jane Austen novel? Emma or Sense and Sensibility?
Sensibility? Because this movie's called Senseless, isn't it?
It's called Clueless.
It is Clueless. But if you watch it, they're all senseless.
Right. Correct. Okay, Rocko. Drew Barrymore played which scandalous tabloid figure in the made-for-TV movie? Did she play Tonya Harding? Tanya Harding? Is that what was it? Or
yeah,
Amy
Harding.
Fisher?
Tanya Harding.
Okay.
I don't know that one at all.
What did?
Like not even close.
Oh, my God. Okay, I know this one.
I mean, clue there.
What did Lorena Bobbitt do to her husband?
Oh.
Held him captive in a basement or cut off his penis? She
yeah, everybody knows that one.
Yeah.
Which Jim Carrey
guy. Guys.
Yeah. Steve, which Jim Carrey film came out first? The Mask or Ace Ventura Pet Detective?
The Mask.
Go. Rocko.
That's a good one, though.
Yeah.
That is a good
one. It's The Mask, no.
Damn, yeah. Look at this.
Because he got really popular from The Mask.
Mm.
And then it was Ace Ventura.
Rocco, in Reality Bites, Winona Ryder's character, Lelaina, declares that she won't work for which retail chain? The Gap or Benetton?
What was this from?
Reality Bites.
Oh, never even seen it. So I'm going to go with, what was the choices?
The Gap or Benetton?
She was working at the Benetton.
I think so, yeah.
What's the Benetton?
I don't know. The 96, because I don't think it's like Gap, because like... I just don't think it's Gap.
I feel like it's going to be like a higher level like drama kind of situation going on of some sort.
The 96, the 96 Summer Olympics were held in which U.S. city? Atlanta or Dallas?
What's it? That's for you, Clay, right?
Yeah, I'm going to say Atlanta.
I'm going to say Dallas.
I'm not sure when they were held here.
96. Do you guys remember the Olympics being around you?
But it looks old. Atlanta, Georgia. Where they had it here.
What were they holding in Atlanta, though?
Why?
In downtown.
No, where were they?
Downtown.
Really?
By the stadium?
Yeah, they have a...
Pretty sure Atlanta.
A big thing there. Yeah, it was. Yeah. I just don't know if it was that was in the 90s or in the 2000s.
They would have it like in a dome?
They had it all over the city of Atlanta, all different stadiums.
Oh, okay.
They had.
That's true.
A portion of whose ear did Mike Bison bite off during a boxing match, Steve? Evander Holyfield or Lennox Lewis?
It was Holyfield.
Yep. Holyfield.
He did it again, though, to like Lennox Lewis, though.
Oh, did he really? Jesus.
Yeah, he did. He bit his ear. Yeah.
The movie,
he didn't
10 Things I Hate About You, Rocco, was based on which Shakespeare play? Much Ado About Nothing? The Taming of the Shrew?
The Taming of the Shrew.
That's what I was going to say. Yeah. Which 90s toy popular... Jesus, it just says 90s toy popular with girls was eventually recalled because it caused too many injuries. Skip It or Sky Dancers?
Oh, Skip It was so cool.
Yeah.
The one you put on your ankle and you slide it around.
I know this one.
I mean, I don't know what Sky Dancers
is. Sky Dancers is like the thing that you pull back and it like flies up in the air. And then it lands, but I think it was hitting children's eyes because they were like looking up at it as it was coming down, and they were being sent to the hospital.
I remember that. Yeah. So I'm gonna say Sky Dancers then. Yeah.
I would go with Skip It.
Because I remember Skip It.
Because I see Skip It like.
It didn't get recalled because Skip It is still being made.
Sky Dancers still kind of. They still kind of are. They're like little helicopter looking things now that you pull for kids. But like the Skip It, all I see with the Skip It is you put it on you're trying to do the Skip It the whole time while you're like walking down a hill or walking or going places and you bust yourself up like by tripping yourself essentially.
Maybe. All right, there's 50 of these and we're on 37.
Are the people that are trying to read the little like Skip It counter?
Right, what is the name of the high school in Boy Meets World? John Abrams High School or Liberty High School?
It was Liberty High School.
I thought it was John Abrams. Steve-O, this is your
John Abrams. It was John Abrams.
Okay. I didn't watch Boy Meets World.
Oh, for fuck's sake. What was the real name of the mysterious unibomber?
It was actually J.J. Abrams.
Eric Menendez?
For who?
Theodore Kaczynski. What was the real name of the mysterious unibomber? Theodore Kaczynski or Eric Menendez?
How could we get all these names?
Or the first guy.
Yeah, no, it's Kaczynski, but...
Is that what I said, though, right?
No, Theodore Kaczynski? Okay, sure, yeah. Which of these is not a Jonathan Taylor Thomas movie? The Adventures of Pinocchio or Jungle to Jungle?
Adventures of Pinocchio. Yeah. Oh, my bad. That was
I was going to say that anyway. What was Aaliyah's first single? Back and Forth, Age Ain't Nothing But a Number. Steve.
I'm going to say Back and Forth.
Yeah. Mm. When the iBook was released in 99, which was not one of the five colors available? Key Lime or Powder Pink?
Powder Pink.
Yeah. I agree with that.
Because I believe that
there was a green.
The green
was
there. And you were like, ugh. I was like, that's a gross.
What was the name of Howard Stern's first book? Miss America or Private Parts?
Private Parts.
Private Parts, for sure.
My bad.
Yeah. No, that's fine.
You're not.
Whose name did Johnny Depp tattoo on his ring finger? Kate Moss or Winona Ryder?
He's pretty old. I'm going to say Kate Moss. Yeah.
And plus, that's like an easier name to put on your finger.
Yeah.
Who is the first host of MTV's House of Style? Cindy Crawford or Claudia Schiffer?
Claudia Schiffer.
I was going to say Cindy Crawford.
for MTV what?
House of Style. You're just picking.
Oh, House of Style.
You don't care anymore.
All right, we'll go with Shepard.
No, I do care. All right, I'm trying to think. House of Styles. I just don't know what that
the
is.
The band Ace of Base was from what country? Sweden or Denmark?
Ace of Base.
I'm pretty sure they're from Sweden.
We can go with Sweden.
All right, let's do this. We're just going. We got five more. Let's do this. Which album turned 20 in 2014? Dookie by Green Day or The Bends by Radiohead?
I remember Dookie by Green Day.
Yeah, so I'm going to say Green Day too.
92. What fashion label was Marc Jacobs fired from for his infamous grunge collection? Joffrey Bean or Perry Ellis?
Perry Ellis.
Let's do that. That's what I know more. I don't know that one. What toy created as a prop in Home Alone 2 actually became a real toy due to popular demand? Talkboy or Yak Boy? Yep. It's definitely. On Saved by the Bell, what is Screech's proper name on the show? Samuel Powers or Seth Finkelstein?
I'm going to say Seth Finkelstein. That sounds more like it.
Yeah, I'm going to go with that one too.
It sounds like a nerd name.
What is a Baby G? A doll that made realistic baby noises? A band of watches popular with 90s girls?
I'm going to say Band of Watches.
Let's do it.
Baby G?
We got 29 out of 50 right. So that's more than half.
Okay, so we lived through it, but we only know. Yeah,
yeah, so.
Or mine.
Some notable ones that we were wrong. Was Jagged Little Pill actually got more?
For the Spice Girls?
Yeah, Jagged Little Pill actually got more. Good Will Hunting was the best screenwriter. The Whack Rolled Around the World was actually the attack on figure skater Nancy Kerrigan. It was Ido for the O.J. Simpson judge. It was Dolly, not Molly. Janka was Judge Nunn. Choose one. Sex
one.
Was the no, actual was right book from Magan. Yeah.
Sex was the name of.
Yeah,
Madonna?
I thought it was erotica.
Oh,
that's
really?
Crazy.
Yeah. See, I
would. Computers would interpret the year 2000 as 1900, which I remember. Okay. Backstreet Boys were created first. Hellmouth was Buffy the Vampire Slayer. let's see. It was Linda Tripp, not Paula Jones. Divine Brown, not Alexis Diamond as the.
I feel like these are all the mine.
Beauty.
Yeah. These are all mine.
Beauty and the Beast. Beauty and the Beast was right, not Lion King, so I was wrong.
That wasn't mine.
Malvin Albright was the Secretary of State, not Janet Reno. It was Emma, mine. Not Sense and Sensibility for Clueless. Ace Ventura came out first, not The Mask. And
what?
It was The Gap, not Bennington. Then we went on a really great streak. It Jungle to Jungle. Which is not a Jonathan Taylor Thomas movie. Jungle to Jungle is not a Jonathan that had.
Oh, it is.
Wait, the other one was. What's
yeah,
the other one?
Yeah, true. Because it had
Pinocchio.
Yeah, who was it the had his yeah, father from. Which
yeah,
is what got
from
me.
From Home Improvement.
Yeah,
yeah, Jungle to Jungle.
It was with Winona Ryder that he got the tattoo of, not Kate Moss. It was Cindy Crawford, not Claudia Schiffer. And his name was Samuel Powers, not Finkelstein. Everything else we were right. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been another episode of the Everything and Nothing Show. We do this every week. Each one of us Maelstrom gamers, we hop on the Skype and we bring five topics for your entertainment. And each of those topics are its own separate video on our YouTube channel. You can get all those free at youtube.com/Maelstrom Gamers channel. And check in on Saturdays where we release all the videos as one big giant episode. And look, if you'd like to support us and give us as little as a dollar, you can go on to patreon.com/Maelstrom Gamers channel. Or sorry, /Maelstrom Gamers. And you can just give us a one-time $1 tip. If you happen to watch this, find something entertaining about us. It'd be really helpful.
Just a tip.
Just to see how, you know, just that feels tip. Like giving us.
Yeah, just see how it feels for a second.
Yeah.
Just
On top of that, there's three ways to support us. Comment, like, subscribe, and share. Like a lot of you guys are doing, so keep that up. Thank you very much. And, yeah, we want to hear from you. So until next week, keep thinking about everything and nothing. It's been an honor to entertain you.
And a pleasure.
I completely
peace.
Blanked out.
Say, where is he going
take
for that one?
Peace and take care. Chicken grease.
I thought he froze for a second.
Yeah, I thought we were supposed to say something. So that's why I just went
honor. Peace. I was like, honor, it's you, honor. Thy fellow sir.
See you later.